Taking photos of fireworks might seem very difficult at first. What camera settings should you use? What aperture? How long shutter speed? And so on and so on. But believe me, it's a very, very simple process, and I'm just about to show you my favorite method of taking photos of fireworks. Hi, my name is Miklos Meyer and I'm a photography tour guide in Budapest, Hungary, and I'm also a night photography lover as well. In this video, I will show you my favorite method to take photos of fireworks. I will guide you along the whole process, from setting up the camera to the post-processing part as well. These are not just simple long exposures, because there's a little bit of twist in both the photography and in the editing part as well. So first of all, what's a good fireworks photo like? In my opinion, the streaks of the fireworks should be visible and they should not be overexposed and clipped, and they should retain their original color. And it's also important not to have too many streaks on one exposure, because then it's gonna look like an overexposed mess. And on the other side, you should not have too little streaks as well, so you have to find a good balance in between. The most often used method, or the traditional method to take fireworks photos, is that you put the camera into bulb mode, and then you start the exposure by pressing the button on the remote release, and then you pay attention to the fireworks, how they are going up, 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 and when you think you have enough light trails exposing onto the sensor, then you stop the exposure by unlocking the button on the remote release. This method is pretty good and many photographers go by this way. But the only downside here is that from shot to shot, you have to really, really focus on how long exposures you are taking. And in a crowded place, this is very hard to do. So my preferred method is a bit different. With shorter, few seconds long exposures, I photograph the whole time span of the fireworks. So for example, I'm shooting with 5 second long exposures, so I'm gonna go 5 seconds, 5 seconds, 5 seconds, 5 seconds, and so on and so on. And these exposures are taken right after each other with virtually no gaps in between the shots. And then in post-production, I have the freedom to select any of the single exposures, or, and this is the fun part, or I can merge multiple exposures together to look like it was a longer exposure. So for example, if there are 3 shots where I really like the light streaks, I can select these 3 shots and merge them together, and then it's gonna look like if I was taking a 15 second long exposure. But I have the freedom in post-production which frames I want to merge together. Not to mention the fact that I don't need to pay that much attention to the camera settings and pressing the exposure button up and down. So now let's dive into this method. Of course, I first put the camera onto a stable tripod and then compose. As always with night photography, I am using RAW file format. This gives me the most amount of flexibility in post-production. I can set the white balance in Lightroom later, I can tweak the levels to a lot more extent than if I was shooting JPEG. So at night, always use RAW file format for the best results. There's a feature in every camera called long exposure noise reduction. This should be turned off in this case, because this feature takes a second exposure, so-called dark frame, after the first normal exposure, and this dark frame is only recorded to remove the hot pixels from the image. But if you leave the long exposure noise reduction on, you will have gaps in between the shots. As I want my photos to have the same identical settings, I put the camera into manual mode so I can fully control the aperture and shutter speed. If I'm using a DSLR, I like to switch to live view mode. This is when the mirror flips up and you see on the screen what the sensor of the camera actually sees. If you have a mirrorless camera though, then it's already in live view, so you don't have to switch to anywhere. Now it's time to find the proper exposure. As the fireworks are usually extremely bright, you will need to stop down the lens to around f11, f16. Or if you go very close to the fireworks, you may even have to use a neutral density, so an ND filter. And then let's set the lowest native ISO speed of the camera, which in this case is ISO 100. Now you might be tempted to use those extended ISO speeds like ISO 50 or ISO 32, but stop. Don't do that. If you use those lower ISO extensions, you will lose details in the highlights. And you definitely don't want that when shooting the fireworks. Ask me how I know. So once the aperture and the ISO speed is set, let's find the proper shutter speed. In this case, I saw that 13 seconds would be good for f16 and ISO 100 to expose the foreground correctly. By the way, here the foreground is the chain bridge and the river Danube in Budapest, Hungary. But in this case, I realized that 13 seconds would be too long. Why? First, the fireworks is really, really bright and it's gonna light up the city anyway. Second, I wanted to have more frames, to have more freedom in the editing part. In a minute, you will see what I mean. As I want to have all my images to have the same focus, I switch to manual focusing. I have already made a very detailed video about manual focusing. I will put a link somewhere up there. It's very simple. I just magnify into the live view and then focus by hand. Now that's in focus and it will stay that way if I don't touch anything. One more minor stuff. Make sure to turn the image stabilization off, either on the lens or in the camera's menu. The camera is going to be on the tripod, so you will not need the stabilization anyway. Then I set the drive mode to continuous and connect the remote release cable. And on the remote release, I am not going to use the program function, but instead I just push down and lock the exposure button. Basically, this will act in the same way as if I was pushing down the exposure button on the camera all the time. If you don't have a remote release, no problem at all. Most cameras have a self-timer continuous drive mode. In this mode, you can set the number of frames the camera should take after a given period. In this case, my Nikon Z50 is going to take 9 exposures after a 2-second delay. Back to where we were. So now the camera is in continuous mode, and once the exposure button is pressed and locked on the remote release, it's going to continuously expose with virtually no gaps in between the shots. And this is exactly what we want now. So for example, if I'm shooting with 5-second long exposures, then in 1 minute I will have roughly 12 frames. And in half an hour, I will have 360 frames. I don't think there's any fireworks in the world that would be longer than 30 minutes. The one in Budapest on 20th of August, St. Stephen's Day, are usually 30 minutes long. So once the fireworks has finished, you will have loads of photos. And now I'm going to show you how you can process these photos. So now I'm going to switch to my computer in 3, 2, 1. I am going to use Adobe Lightroom Classic for the first part and then Photoshop for the second part. I've already imported the fireworks photos into Lightroom Classic and put them into a separate collection. Now I select the frames that have light trails I like. And even among the normal single exposures, there are quite many photos that I like just by themselves. I really like this one, this, and this. First, I process one of the frames, for example, this one. I jump over to Develop Module by pressing D on the keyboard. I push the exposure up a bit, but now the highlights are blown out, so I pull the highlights slider down and push the shadows a bit up. Maybe add some vibrance for more saturated colors. Now the white balance looks a bit too warm, too yellowish, so I pull the Kelvin slider down. Not too much, this will be good. You can see that although I used f16 aperture, this part is still overexposed a bit, so an ND filter would have been handy. I will pull the color temperature a bit further down, somewhere here, I think that's fine. Maybe tone the highlights a bit more down, so more colors will come out. I am done editing this photo, so now I jump back to the grid view, and now I will copy the settings of this edited photo onto the other selected photos. This one, and this one. The settings of this edited photo will be synchronized onto the other photos. I want all parameters to be synced, so I click on check all and then synchronize. And now you can see that these photos have the same editing as this one has. And now comes the extra part. As these five photos are already edited, I want to layer these frames on top of each other to create longer light trails on a single photo. With the five frames selected, I right-click on them and go for Edit In and Open as Layers in Photoshop. Photoshop then fires up and loads each photos as individual layers, and that's exactly what we want now. Great, all photos are here now as separate layers. Although I used a tripod, it may happen that the shots are not perfectly lined up, simply because I may have nudged the camera or the tripod due to the crowds. So I have to align the layers to each other. I click on the top layer, hold down Shift, and then click on the bottom layer, and then I go Edit, Auto Align Layers. Auto is good. Okay, and now Photoshop automatically aligns the layers. You can see that some white area appeared on the side, so Photoshop really had to move layers to match them. I go for 100% view, and now I can check if the layers are aligned accurately. If I hold down the Alt key and click here, then it solos the layer, so only that layer will be visible. Everything looks alright, so I select all the layers back and go back to full view. And now comes the key step. I select all layers and change the blending mode to Lighten. And that's all. Lighten blending mode always picks the brightest pixels of the layers. So what you see here are the brightest pixels from these five layers at any position. If I deselect any of these layers, then those light trails will of course disappear. I don't want too many streaks on the final photo, because then it will have an overexposed look. I think now it looks a lot better. So now the final image has only three single exposures in it. This is the bottom, this is the top part, and this is sort of the end of the top part. As you can see, they were consecutive frames in real life too, so I am not manipulating the reality here. Now I'm ready, I finished stacking in Photoshop, so I press Command or Control S to save my work. Jumping back to Lightroom, I can see that my stacked photo is already there and has Edit in its file name. I switch to Develop Module again to crop this little white band off of the photo. This white line was created by Photoshop when it was aligning the frames together, and some frames had to be moved, and below that the canvas was white. I activate the crop tool, I go for the 2:3 aspect ratio and crop the photo a bit to get rid of the white bands. And now the editing is done, the photo is ready. I usually mark my edited finished photos with a green label, so I press 8 on the keyboard. So this is how a single exposure looked like, and this is the three frames stacked together.
So that is my stacking method to photograph fireworks. I hope that I could help you take better photos next time when you are out there and shooting fireworks. If you are new to night photography, you may find that you have to pay attention to a lot of things when setting up the camera,
And these are small things that you normally don't have to pay attention to, but at night it's a bit different. So I've put together a checklist where I list all these important items to go through, and you can download this checklist in a PDF. Just click on the first link in the description down below. It's free, and you can use this PDF as a guide. You can download it to your phone, and it will help you when setting up for a shot. If you liked the video, please hit on the like button, and also you can subscribe to my channel and you will not miss any of my new content. See you soon and all the best from Hungary.